He was also named one of the top 100 thought leaders in the world by Leadership Magazine. Fast Company hailed David, one of the world's most influential thinkers in the arena of personal productivity. And his book, I'm just curious, how many of you have read Getting Things Done? Okay. I know I have a couple, both in my Atlanta house and here. And the audio, exactly. So anyway, best-selling author. Now, what's interesting is I don't think you would think you're necessarily a social media expert. I checked his Twitter account the other day. He's got over like 1.2 million? 1.2 million. So we're going to just do a quick little interview sit-down style, and then we'll open up for Q&A. So make sure you're writing down your questions, and we'll have a lively discussion. So first of all, thank you for being here.
Delighted to be here. Thanks.
All right. So I found this morning. I couldn't believe this. So magician, waiter, karate teacher, landscaper, vitamin distributor, glass blowing operator, travel agent, gas station manager, U-Haul dealer, 35 different professions before age 35. How does one go from that to being the top productivity expert in the world?
Your only two options are flake or consultant.
Okay.
Right, so I hopefully took the positive route and hung out my shingle. I just like to show up and look around and say, how much easier can we make whatever it is you're doing? People said, gee, David, have you always been organized? I said, no, I have always been the laziest guy you ever met. I wake up in the morning and go, how much easier can I get from here to there? I do. I mean, if I'm going to cross the room, I have already figured out with the least effort, how do I get over there? It doesn't mean that I'll take that route, because if you know where you're going, efficiency and style are your only two improvement opportunities. So I might want to style, you know, down that side or down that side. But at least I know if I want it there, that's where it is. Long story short, I just discovered I really like to go in and look around at what people were doing and see how much easier could they do that so they could be freed up to do sort of more of what they really wanted to do. And then I discovered they actually pay people money to do that, and they call them something called, wasn't a consultant, couldn't spell it, now I are one. So that's how I got into the game. And I got into the game just simply because I said, look, you know, I just knew a bunch of friends. I was in LA, and I had people starting their own businesses, small businesses, and whatnot. So I just said, look, let me just show up and see if I can produce value for them. And at the same time, I was just hungry myself for what are the coolest tools that I could use to stay clear. And so, you know, people said, gee, David, did you wake up one morning with the big epiphany of getting things done? It's like, no, you're looking at a long string of epiphanets, you know, that I just began to knit together and began to use. So there was a lot of ready, fire, aim. I just started using this stuff. Hey, God, that works. Ooh, that worked better. And I started to build that. So that was that transition back way before you were born.
Gotcha. So what's the foundation? So for some reason, someone hasn't read your book. It doesn't use your system. So what would be the fundamental philosophies and principles of getting things done more efficiently?
One way to think about it is that if you're still using your psyche as your system, it sucks. Your psyche is not designed for remembering and reminding. It's designed to be a channel for your intuitive intelligence about making choices of your options. But most people are still using their psyche as their system. They're using their head to remind them who they need to call. They're using their head to say, what are my priorities? They're using their head to do all that. And the head should have thoughts once. I need cat food should pop into your head once. Right? If it pops in a second time, you're inappropriately engaged with your commitment. So all I did was I began to uncover and make explicit, implicitly, what works. How do we stay clear? A way to say it, and here's my 20-second getting things done. It'll save you all the time, you know, and money to buy the book.
You don't think they could afford the 20?
Yeah, well. Yeah,
like, times are tough, you know.
Yeah, and understood. Well, if you really just get this, you can create your own systems. But what to get is any potentially meaningful thing you can't finish the moment you think of it needs to be captured externally in some trusted place. Sooner than later, you need to look at what that is and decide more discreetly, what exactly am I going to do about that in terms of outcomes and actions. You then need to park the results of that thinking in appropriate categories so that some part of you doesn't have to keep rethinking what does that mean. And then you need to step back and review the whole gestalt or the whole picture of all the different horizons of your commitments so that then you trust your heart, the seat of your pants, or your gut to then make a good intuitive choice about what you're doing, and probably more importantly, feeling okay about what you're not doing. But if you don't know what you're not doing, you'll never feel comfortable not doing it. So that's the 22nd getting things done. It's really, that's in a sense, that simple.
What?
Yeah, and you know what's fascinating is that is actually life-changing. It's just that what I just said are huge habits. Most of you in here, it'll take you 2 years if you're really, really good before you've changed that habit of keeping stuff in your head. I mean, that's if you're really good.
So let's look at the opposite. Since you said you're lazy, you like the fastest way shortcut.
Yeah.
What is the fastest way for someone to change their habits to become more productive so they can get more stuff done?
Read my good friend Charles Duhigg's new book called The Power of Habits. Fabulous book. Charles is a big GTD, is a fan of my stuff. And he's written a lot of very cool stuff about it. One of the biggest keys that he writes about, Charles Duhigg, D-U-H-I-G-G.
It's called The Power of Habit,
The Power of Habit.
It's a big, thick book, yeah?
Yeah, it's a new hardback this summer. He's a New York Times journalist. It's fascinating. Great stories in there. It's really an easy read and very, very inspiring. One of the key elements that he talks about is a keystone habit. And a keystone habit says pick the habit that if you do that one, a lot of the dominoes are going to fall. Don't try to change 22 habits. What's the one habit that will make the biggest difference? You know, a great example of that is a habit of putting on your exercise gear when you wake up. Don't even commit to running. Just put on your gear. Some of you know exactly what I'm talking about. And you start to build that habit. And he talks about cue, action, and reward, because that's, you don't, by the way, get rid of habits. You change them. So you find what's the habitual behavior I'm in, and how do I refocus that a little bit? So find the ones or two that are really cool. In terms of our work, the one habit is getting stuff out of your head, and the second habit is to empty your inbox where you've dumped all that stuff, you know, on a consistent basis. Those two things, just because there's all kinds of stuff that I just absolutely hate to have to think about or decide about. But because I built the habit of getting my in-basket to zero, it makes me make those decisions simply because I want to see that sucker empty. That's a keystone habit. So I don't want to have to go out and make myself do all the big, heavy-duty things.
Let me get this straight. If I looked in your inbox right now, it would be down to zero?
No, there's never zero. There's always stuff coming in, but it was zero last night.
Wow, that's impressive. I got 60,000 like emails in that Gmail. I guess I got to figure out how to...
Well, you get your answer machine empty and you get your physical mailbox empty. True. What's the difference?
True.
Size and volume. That's all.
Let me ask you a question. Talking about habits. And by the way, does that mean if someone sleeps in their sneakers and their gym clothes, they get six-pack abs, or that's not the habit?
You know, that's an idea. That's an idea.
I like that.
Yeah.
Okay, on a serious note. So what is your habit? What's, you know, give us the first hour of your day in terms of your organ, or either late at night, what's the last thing you're doing, or first thing in the morning to have an organized, productive day?
Well, I think the main key, or what I'm referring to now, is as maps. I need to look at the right map. I just need to be oriented. Everybody in this room looked at some map to orient yourself that today is where you needed to be, and that there wasn't anything blowing up on you out there. So what's that map? Well, a calendar is the most obvious map a lot of people need to see. First thing I look at, what's my hard landscape? What'll die if I don't do it today? So the calendar has time-specific stuff. It also has stuff that has to happen that day. It also has stuff I need to know on that day. Those are the three things that go on a calendar. So that's a great map to have to begin with. So I go, okay, you know, there's not many other options from that standpoint. That's about the hard landscape. Then it's really, you know, all the other stuff. And, you know, a calendar only has a small percentage of all of your commitments. So there's all those other lists of the commitments that I have. And I don't look at those every hour, every day, heavens no. But once a week, man, I look at it all. It's called the weekly review. That's another keystone habit, is once a week taking 2 weeks and pulling up the rear guard, defining all the new projects that have shown up that you haven't had time to think about yet, making sure that all of your projects have current actions defined about them so you don't have any dust lying fallow on any of your commitments, and just stepping back and sort of seeing the whole picture and the whole gestalt. Everybody in here, if you just looked at the last 2 weeks in your calendars, by the way, closely, the last 2 weeks, all the people you've met with, every one of you is going to come up with at least 4 or 5 OSs. Oh, sugar, that reminds me I need to. And I guarantee you, every one of you, if you look at the next 4 weeks in your calendar, right now, every one of you is going to come up with a bunch of, oh, God, you know, I ought to, ooh, that'd be cool. So nothing changed except you just looked at the right map to start to get oriented appropriately. And unfortunately, most people only look at the map when they got run over, as opposed to, that's where I want to go, or that's what I need to do, that's what I need to do. So which maps do I need to see? Basically, my driver is, what do I need to do so there's nothing on my mind? That's it. You know, you can never have nothing on your mind if you're conscious. But if the only thing that's on your mind is the only thing that's on your mind, then you're in your zone. So right now, there's nothing on my mind. That may be evident. Not much going on up here. But there's nothing here. But so I just need to do what I need to do so that I'm free to be wherever I am, be fully there. That's what I figured out, was how to do that. Because I discovered years ago, I mean, it was my martial arts training, really, and a lot of the spiritual work that I've also was in, that sort of convinced me or gave me the experience of what I now refer to as the strategic value of clear space. Strategic value of clear space. If any of you are going to cook dinner for friends, you know, they're coming over at 6 and it's 5 o'clock, how do you like your kitchen to start? Probably nice and clean, nice and organized, you got all the right tools, you got everything in the right place, because that gives you the freedom to make a creative mess. You will be most productive, by the way, when you have the opportunity to make a creative mess. Any of you writers, you know, you need room to sit down and make mistakes, write a shitty first draft, write a shitty 63 drafts, but you need the freedom to be able to do that in order to then find what, you know, what's there. So it's kind of like the Hemingway, you know, write drunk, edit sober. You know, yeah, me too. So
how do you actually?
So I'm just always clearing the deck so that we can, you know, make a mess here.
So the key to writing a best-selling book and selling millions of copies is a good bottle of wine? Or what's your style of, on a serious note, what is your preferred style of writing? Are you talking and having it transcribed, or, you know, what's your style?
My style is basically to pull up Microsoft Word and just start writing ideas and thoughts and concepts. Depends on what I'm writing. If I'm writing a blog, or if I'm writing an article, or I'm, you know, looking at something bigger, I may start with a mind map. Usually I've got mind maps. I use Mind Manager on my computer. So that's where if I'm really kind of dumping all over the place and don't even have a thematic approach to it yet, that's probably what I'll do. And then I go to a more linear version of that, which is I'll just go to Word. I'll just start writing paragraphs. You know, as a concept comes in, I'll write it. And of course, the cool thing about word processors is you can cut and paste and move stuff around. You know, so it's a way to brainstorm, but I tend to brainstorm more by starting to write. I've got to get the flow going in some way, shape, or form. And a lot of times, and by the way, I leave several spaces between each paragraph. That helps to say, okay, here's a thought. Let me flesh that thought out. Invariably, when I start fleshing that thought out, you know, another thought will pop in, and so I may skip another two lines and then start another paragraph to get that thought sort of nailed down. At some point, the whole thing starts to have a flow to it, but usually after at least a few nights of sleeping on it. That's why I give myself false deadlines if I'm writing articles. Man, I got so pissed off when I would wait till the final deadline to write something, and after I turned it in 2 days later, I'd go, oh my God, I should have said. And I really realized, and they've done studies now that show, especially in terms of decision making, and any of you writing, that's constant decision making and thinking. You know, thinking is hard work. And so sort of priming the pump and then going to sleep, because the unconscious then doesn't have the preconditionings that your conscious mind does. So that's where people come up with good ideas. That's where they come up with knitting things together. They didn't see how those things related together. So I try to give myself at least a few days ahead as a deadline, if I have a deadline, so that I can finish as best I can, and then I sleep on it, and then just see what shows up. And invariably, I'll get better ideas or more stuff to add into it. So that'd be one of my real practical tips if anybody's writing out there. If you're not doing that.
In terms of finishing and not having things drop through the cracks, a lot of these people are incredibly busy. Some consult, some have keynote speeches, they may have tons of meetings, and through those meetings, through the course of the day, there's a lot of action items. You know, maybe get a. So, what's the best way so a lot of that stuff is not going to fall through the cracks? And from an indexing or organizational standpoint, I mean, are you recommending a day planner? Is it keeping it in the notebook? Is it, you know, getting it into an electronic? You know, like, you know, we use iPhone. I'm just curious, what's some best practices there?
It doesn't matter what your system is, but you need a system. So, you know, you can do it low tech, high tech, mid tech. Low-tech would be just keeping file folders with just trigger reminders inside the folders. Here's all the calls I need to make. They're on scraps of paper. That works fine as long as you've got it wrapped around it. That's what those are. Basically, you just need, obviously, you need a calendar, but you need a list manager. You need something that manages categories of things. And you've got to get this stuff out of your head, guys. You know, if it's in your head, it's in the wrong place, if that's the only place it is. So you, first of all, there's a different function between just dumping stuff out of your head and an organization system. Those are very different behaviors, and they have very different success factors to them and very different tools. I mean, my capture tool is right here. Ta-da, the David Allen note taker wallet. It comes in brown and black, espresso brown. Well, I designed it because nobody made one just the right size so that it fit both in tuxedo and jeans, you know, with a way wicked cool pin in the middle. Oh, come on, folks, it is.
That is cool.
It is sophistication, not senility. That the older you get, the more good ideas will not happen where you're going to implement that idea. You'll be buying bread at the store thinking it's something you need to bring up in a marketing meeting. You'll be in the marketing meeting remembering you need bread. So if you don't want to have a thought twice, I mean, why have a thought twice? Unless you like the thought, there's no reason for it. You know, people's psychic footprint is absolutely obscene. You know, and so reducing psychic footprint, first of all, you have to capture the stuff. Good, bad, or indifferent, you actually don't know whether it's good, bad, or indifferent right then. That's why you want to over-capture. I throw away 80% of 90% of these notes. The next morning, it's like, who are you kidding? But I don't know which 10% are going to be gold. And pretty much my whole life and work style started with ideas that I didn't know what they were going to do, but I had to get them out. So capturing those to begin with, and then throwing these will all go in my in-basket, which will then get zeroed out. What is that? What do I need to do? Is that important or not? And then action items that I then need to take, phone calls I need to make, emails I need to draft, documents I need to review or edit, you know, websites I need to surf, stuff I need to talk to my wife about. All that stuff just goes on lists so that when I'm in those contexts, I can pull that list up and go, oh, okay, I'm here. I can now do these things. So just organizing reminders of that. And this is the big duh. I mean, every one of you does versions of that. I mean, the reason you have it, how many of you use a calendar? Yeah, why? Because your head can't do it. Jeez. So what about the 95% of the rest of your life? How come it's in your head? You can't do it. So, you know, people see all my lists, they go, God, that's too many lists. I go, well, do you have a calendar? I say, yeah, well, throw your calendar away. Don't be intellectually dishonest. Either your head's the place to do this stuff or it's not. And you can guess pretty much what I bet on that. So you do need a system. You need something that you can then feed back and orient yourself. Wow, I'm at a phone with discretionary time. Let me see a list of all the phone calls that I need to make.
So is it literally labeled phone calls with discretionary time?
No. If it's something that I have to do specific to a day or a time, that's on the calendar. All the other is as soon as I can. So all my other lists are as soon as I can, except my someday maybe list. Someday maybe list says, I'm not sure if I want to do that yet at all, but I want to rethink that on some consistent basis to see if I'm ready to activate any of those. But everything else goes, it wouldn't be on the list if I didn't want to do it. But some of those have been on there for months. Why? I just never made it to the top. But that's okay, because I'm in the right context with the right frame of mind and the right energy. That's still something I wanted to do.
How many different lists or categories are you talking about?
I have about 7 or 8.
Sharing at a high level what those are?
Sure. Well, first of all, you need a list of all your projects. That's a very different list than your actions. And projects are something that most people have trouble kind of understanding what I mean by that, especially if you think about projects as big construction projects or something like that. But projects are get tires on my car, your next holiday, hire an assistant, research whether I want the iPhone 5 or not. Those are projects. Anything that's going to take you more than one step to get to some completion about is something we identify as a project, and most of you have between 30 and 100 of those. That's a typical number right now. I've met a few people with more and a few people with less, but that's most of you probably have 40, 50, 60 if you actually sat down and identified all the things that you're committed to finish within the next year that are going to take you more than one step to finish it. And a lot of those haven't even been identified. In other words, if you've got a problem out there, there are no problems. There are just still unclarified projects. Right, your son comes home with a bad math grade. Well, what's the project? I need to look into what's going on with that situation, whether there's anything to change. That's a project. So I got a lot of R&D projects, all you do as well. All those things you need to clarify, resolve, or whatever. So if you lump all those together, that is an incredible map to have. It's just a list of all your projects. And a lot of them don't need many more thoughts than just, okay, I just need to get tires on my car and just hold on to that until I get tires on the car and I can check it off. But the project list is really one of the most critical lists. Then you have all the next actions that you need to take. What are the very next things you need to do that are going to move the needle on any of these projects? And most of you have between 30 and 100 projects, and most of you have between 150 and 220 next actions right now. If you were to truly capture that inventory and clarify all the things you need to do on any moving part, that's emails to send, errands to run, things to talk to people about, things to do at your computer, whatever. And then we discovered if you have 150 of those, it actually simplifies it to sort those by what can I possibly do in any one place and time, that is by context. So we've found over the years that it's a lot easier to organize, once you have those next actions, is to sort them by either the tool or the location required. So if you looked at my list, I have a calls list. Call anytime I'm at a phone, you know, that's where that is. I can see that. At computer, right? I actually have three different kind of at computer lists. I have at computer web, and at computer surf. Those are three very different contexts for me, because I'm on planes a lot that still don't have Wi-Fi.
Can you believe that's pretty crazy, huh?
I know, it's crazy. But
they need to get more organized to get their act together.
No kidding, get their act together. So anyway, when I'm on a plane, I don't need to see things that, if I'm not wired, I don't need to see a lot of stuff that requires me being connected to the web. So it just simplified it for me to sort those into, here's at home, at office, at the computer, at the phone, errands to run, and then stuff to talk to my wife about, stuff to talk to my CEO about, whatever, and just listing in terms of agendas. So it's pretty common sense. It's not like way out of control. Some people like just two or three lists. Doesn't matter, as long as you have them somewhere so that some part of you knows you're not missing anything in terms of options, in terms of what you could do at any point in time. So those are pretty much it. I have lots of different kind of cool lists that I just keep in, you know, other places. You know, travel checklist. If I'm going to a retreat, what are the different kind of things that I need to take there? You know, how do I access my voicemail in a place that I don't get to very often? You know, I got all kinds of lists. So those are all kept in there. And I have a digital form of that, but man, I used a paper-based calendar for 20 years. It's hard to beat a loose-leaf notebook in terms of visual context. And I know a lot of high-tech people that are actually going back to paper, simply because paper matches how the brain actually thinks a lot. Computer is not very good for you to be able to see a big map to orient yourself. Most people boot your computers and get confused, you know, as opposed to, whoa, now I can see the larger context of this. So I know quite a number of fairly high-tech people that have gone back to paper planners now because it's a lot more conscious and they can see them in relationship to each other. They're bad and good news. I use a computer for most all of my stuff as well.
So you're not using any smartphones to house any of the, it's literally all in that one book?
Yeah. Actually, I just switched from the BlackBerry to the iPhone 5, and they're just switching that. So they haven't switched it yet on my server, so they have to run that through, because we use Lotus Notes, and they have to buy a third-party thing, and they got to get it up, and it's not running yet. But that's okay.
So that would go into project or action? No, I'm kidding.
Yeah. No, trust me, it's on my project list to get that done. But I travel with my laptop. I've got a MacBook that I travel with that has all that stuff in it. And, you know, I travel with that pretty much anywhere that I'm going to do work anyhow. But see, the cool thing about it is if you zero out your backlog as often as I do, I don't need to carry any of this shit with me. I don't even need those lists. Why? All I need is this little thing right here, because if it's all I need to then tell me to go back to where I have those lists if I happen to think of something. So this is pretty much a lot of times all I'm carrying. Because I've also looked at all of it, so I knew nothing was going to blow up on me today. But 95% of my usage of my own system is to give me the freedom to follow my spontaneous intuitive hunches without worrying about anything else. Because that's where your success is going to come from anyway. But if you're using your psyche to keep trying to track and remember and remind all of this crap, then you're losing the opportunity for very sophisticated kind of spontaneity, which is really the end game of getting things done, of doing that. The secret, folks, is not about getting things done. It's about being appropriately engaged with your world. Are you appropriately engaged with your dog? Are you appropriately engaged with your relationships? Are you appropriately engaged with the SAN conference? Are you appropriately engaged? That's all. That's all it's about. Because if you can only put your conscious attention on one thing at a time, that's either half empty or half full. It's either that is the one thing to put your attention on and everything else can wait, or you're feeling crappy about what you're not doing. So anyway, that was probably a longer answer than what you asked about, but you got me started. So.
Let's talk and switch gears.
Okay.
So was it 2001 you said the book came out?
Yep.
Okay. So
took 4 years to write it. Man, that was tough.
4 years. Oh. So I think you may have said at the time you were doing about $5,000 per speech, got up as high as $50,000 per speech. So let's walk us through how does one become, you know, one of the top five executive coaches in the world? How does one become, you know, the top productivity expert in the world? That obviously, like, what was the path? Like, was there some specific leverage points?
Just putting one foot in front of the other, and you know, it's kind of back to Malcolm Gladwell's 10,000 hours. I got 100,000 hours. You know, literally in terms of how much time I've sat down and spent with the best and brightest and busiest people in the world, working with stuff. I think the big key for me was that early on, some of this material that I started to work with just had powerful results with people, without exception. Anybody sits down and empties their head, I guarantee you, feels more in control and more focused on what they're doing. You know, this, you're not like running with scissors when you try to do any of this stuff. This is, everything you do about this was really great. And I started to see that work. And, you know, my thing is just to improve the planet and help people improve their world. And so to have something immediately that without fail for five-year-old kids and CEOs of companies, and also the laziest guy in the world, I actually found something that I didn't have to change what I said no matter who I talked to. So this is a customized saying speech, by the way. Yeah, you're kidding. So that was nice because I don't have to change what I say. And finding something that was that universal that automatically worked. Now, I thought I was the last guy in the world to figure this out. I was just sort of handling my own little boutique kind of lifestyle consulting business. And I thought all the big, senior, sophisticated, you know, high-level executive folks would have already figured this out and I would be bored, they'd be bored stupid with my stuff. Wrong answer to that. I discovered the higher up and more sophisticated people got, the more weird, ambiguous, and incomplete their life becomes, and the more they're avoiding a whole lot of things they need to think about. Come on, if you're just cranking widgets, you're not avoiding that. You show up at a big pile of uncranked widgets, make it real clear what to do, and you feel real comfortable that you cranked a bunch of widgets today, you go home and have a beer, put your feet up, and you are clear. But if you're trying to implement diversity amongst your widget crankers, or decide whether widgets are what you need to be cranking 2 years from now or not, later. So as people got more sophisticated, what I was uncovering was becoming that much more perceived value to them. A big break came when, you know, I was doing a little workshop around this, and I had a guy who was a young Turk, kind of a smart, brilliant guy, actually, was brought in to run head HR and OD for Lockheed. And he saw me do this work, and he said, "Oh my God, David, could you take that and design a seminar around this in education? Because I think you've got a key there that our executives need," in terms of his assessment of their culture. So I went, okay. So he gave me the freedom. I worked with his OD team for about 2 or 3 months to then design a 2-day productivity seminar around the material that I developed. And it hit a nerve. I still didn't know what I had figured out and that how unique it was. It took me 25 years to figure out what I'd figured out. Because I'd been doing this work for 25 years before I finally decided to write that book. You know, and 97 was when I said, you know, nobody, if I get run over by a bus, somebody will probably figure this out, but I better get it out right now because we need to write the manual.
What took you so long out of curiosity? That's 25 years of tremendous knowledge.
I didn't trust it was right, or that it was the best. I didn't know. I mean, I'm not the kind of da-da kind of guy out there called, you know, I'm going to go do something and then figure out later if it actually worked. I actually really, really had to make sure. This was going to be a lot of my life had been gone into this, so I just really needed to test this. Now, the good news about this was while I was writing this, I was coaching some of the top senior people and a lot of them. And there's believe me, if their immune system would spit you out in 2 seconds if you couldn't stand toe-to-toe with the absolute best and brightest and busiest people on the planet. And it went viral inside that culture. So I said, well, if it worked here, it's probably good enough for the rest of the world. I don't think anybody else will punch a hole in it. So that I had to have that level of confidence in terms of the material itself to actually sit down and write. Because, you know, writing ain't my day job. And it took me a year to figure out how do you write a book? You know, and do I get an agent? Do you go write to editors? Do you go to the publisher? What do you do to write a business plan for the book? Whatever. It took a year to write the business plan and get that right and to get the deal. And then it took a year to write the first draft, and the first draft didn't make it. It just didn't, it wasn't as good as I needed to be. I literally just dropped that in the can and started again. It took the third year, I wrote the next draft.
Wow.
Because I wrote the first book like I did a seminar, and it doesn't work that way. The book is a very different medium. I had a fabulous editor at Viking Penguin at the time, Janet Goldstein, and Janet was a great coach for that. And it just, you know, she said, David, you need to write like you've got your hand on their shoulder. That's a very different model about how to think about somebody doing this. And I just wrote it kind of the way I did the seminar, because if it got 2 days for a seminar, you can bring everybody along into whatever you're doing. But you've got to catch people in a very different way when they're reading a book, whether it's an armchair book or whether they're on a plane, whether it's something else. So that was a great lesson for me, but man, that was a tough call to do that while I've got a day and a half job. You know, the biggest mistake in the world was thinking that after breakfast meeting, you know, in Washington, D.C., standing up all day and doing an 8-hour stand-up, instructor-led seminar, then having drinks and dinner with a client, then being on a plane for 2 hours, assuming I'd write the next chapter. Ha ha! Who are you kidding? You know, so back to your question, what's the biggest key there? What the biggest key was never start to write anything without a big 4-hour window. Because otherwise, I really just stepped on myself, and I just didn't have the energy to wrap myself around the content and the material. So that was a big learning. So that was year three. Year four was to get the title right, to get the typeset right, to get the look right, to get the how many positions for the marketplace out there right. So that was an agonizing 4 years. Well, it's funny to write a book about stress-free productivity and have it almost kill you.
So before I take questions, I believe most people learn more from their failures and setbacks than they do their successes. You've had a lot of success. What's been your biggest setback or failure, and what have you learned?
I've sometimes been asked that question, and I have a hard time answering that, because just in my general philosophy and take on life is that it's everything has a reason that it happens. And then what do I learn from that? And they say you teach what you need to learn the most, so I probably had the most unfocused, disorganized, out-of-control life you can imagine, just as a way to that's kind of who I am. I sort of hung out and, just discovered that didn't really work very well. So I think probably the biggest mistake is my own sense of, probably for all of us, but it's really my own sense of self-image and self-esteem. It's called, this stuff is really good. And I've done a really, really, really good job with it. And my willingness to sort of stand out and put it out that way and to tell the world, hey guys, wake up. You know, where the world is going, this is a must-have. So I wouldn't call it a failure yet, but it's probably been one of my biggest limitations was my hesitation to really wear the marketing hat, and to do a little more ta-da, about this.
Interesting. So anyone want to ask a few questions? And if you do, why don't you just go to the mic? For the video, just what's your name and the question?
Scott Meyer from Content Engine. Two questions for you. Curious about batching. You talk a lot about batching. Have you seen it be effective to have a set amount of time every day to do a certain type of task? Like at 9 a.m. every day, I'm going to go through my internet browsing stuff. And secondly, when do you know that lists are becoming a distraction, that I'm just making more categories and lists because I don't actually want to go to the list that I already have?
Yeah. Good questions. First of all, in terms of batching stuff or time blocking, I think that's very, very situational and dependent on your personality and how you work. The only thing I do consistently is wake up, and sometimes that's in question too. And so I don't really do that much. A great habit to get in, by the way, in terms of that stuff, by the way, it's kind of a sidebar on it, but another friend of mine, Tony Schwartz, if any of you know Tony's work, out there. Tony's done some great stuff. And a lot of his is about how do you restore your energy. But one of the best habits he had, and I've picked it up from him, is just do the toughest thing first. Whatever you're avoiding, do that one first. And then snack on email as a reward. A lot of people go to email because it's snacky. It's like, ooh, that's kind of, ooh, that's fun. And email can be highly addictive because it has the highly addictive quality, which is random positive reinforcement. Random positive reinforcement will addict you to something, more than anything else. If you're trying to train a dog or anything like that. And email kind of has that. One of the suggestions that I would have is as best you can, hold off doing email till the afternoon if your energy's better in the morning. Because email is one of those things where you can kind of do it a little quicker and a little easier, and a lot of that is kind of quick and easy turnarounds and clean it up and whatever, and sometimes you're better off doing that without so much energy. But sometimes you need a lot of energy to do email, too. So I think it's very different for individuals there. I don't have a, what I, my biggest caution is don't set yourself up for failure there. Don't give yourself a rule and break it, because then that's going to lower your self-trust. So if you're going to do it, make sure you stick with it. So, you know, it's kind of like kids and dogs, make yourself as few rules as you can get by with and stick to them. Mm-hmm. Otherwise, you'll kind of undermine the value of any of that, quote, discipline. Your second question was, how do you know when you're, the line between intuitive holding on something and procrastination is very thin. Very thin. I think, how well do you know yourself? But come on, there are worse ways to waste your time than productivity porn. You know, hey, give me, you could take drugs. I mean, if you're going to waste your time, at least have a hobby like, you know, explore new productivity software. Wow, that'd be cool. You know, that's it's kind of like, yeah, I understand that there is a point of diminishing returns about getting organized. I only get organized so that there's nothing on my mind. If there's nothing on my mind, I'm as organized as I need to be. So the only reason I do any more organizing is because something is distracting me without the trust in the system. So I need to build the trust in the system so I get back to spontaneity again. So that's my cue and clue for everything. Call, look, if there's something on my mind, what do I need to do to get it off my mind right now? And that may mean I need to restructure my lists. You know, when I hired a CEO, I spent several months restructuring my job. I had to keep rethinking it. Wait a minute, stop doing that, David. That's Mike's stuff now. And I had to keep rethinking that. So I think we all need to consistently reinvest in our own process. I'll tell you where GTD and getting things done really hits a nerve out there is in the episodic parts of your life. The people who write to us about where GTD really works is when they suddenly have kids, or now the kids have just left, or they've just bought a house, or they're just selling their house, or they just got fired, or they've just been acquired by another company, or they've just published a book, or whatever it is. At those times, usually your systems, that's when the weakness shows up in terms of your systems. So that's where people go, oh, God, I need something. Your system, most people's systems are tenuous enough that when those kinds of things hit them, you know, boy, you can really feel overwhelmed. And so that's where a lot of people come on board with GTD. That's why, you know, a lot of my message out there, God, do this before those things hit, so that when they hit, you're really ready to, you know, integrate that change very fast.
So I just want to ask you a quick question before you. On the implementation of ideas fast, with the top senior executives that you've worked with, I mean, most of these people here are just crazy nuts, busy with their schedules. How much time does it take to really go implement an improved system? How much time are these executives taking a step back to change up?
Well, to set up the system doesn't take that long. You know, I've worked with a lot of executives for 1 or 2 days, and sometimes it depends on how close they were to begin with and how computer savvy they are and whether they want to do that and they have the tools already to do it. Because all you really need are structuring lists. So you can structure Outlook task as a list to have, you know, as long as you do it that way. We have a white paper on how to do that, by the way. It's a very simple way to kind of restructure some of these applications so they become good, powerful list managers. And it doesn't take it takes 20 minutes to set that up. It takes about 2 days to populate it with all the stuff you need to get in there, and then about 2 years to learn how to work it habitually. So if you're talking about just setting up the system, that doesn't take very long. If you get getting things done, if you have that book, part two of getting things done actually walks you through our coaching process that usually takes 2 days, you know, to walk somebody through. Because it takes 1 to 6 hours just to capture everything that's got people's attention right on the front end. 1 to 6 hours is the typical amount of time it takes for us to sit down and gather together all the both physical representations of open loops sitting around people's offices. Because anything that's not supplies or reference material or decoration or equipment is something that's an open loop, some incomplete that you've got. And the reason you've got it lying around is because some part of you says, I need a reminder that there's something there for me to do. But we just regather all that stuff and put it back in your in-basket. We get you an in-basket to begin with. You wouldn't believe how many people don't even have an in-basket. But we just pile all that up together. Then we do anything else on your mind that's not in this pile. Oh, yeah, I got to call Bill. Oh, that's right, I need to redo the street. Oh, that's right, I need to. And that takes 1 to 6 hours. I had to take 16 hours for a guy one time. Finally, I just told him, well, you get the idea. He wasn't stupid. This was the chairman of two companies. Right? But he was a crazy maker. He would just be halfway through something, get another bright idea, just leave that one. The problem was he was semi-retired, so he didn't have 12 assistants following around like little puppies picking up all the balls he's throwing in the air. So he still got the habit of throwing balls in the air, just nobody's picking them up. He's just running into them. Anyway, so that takes just a few, you know, 1 to 2 to 3 hours just to do a true mind dump, get everything out of your head, little, big, personal, professional. Write them all on separate scraps of paper, throw those in your in basket along with all the other miscellaneous stuff. Then it takes the rest of 2 days just to go through that, asking yourself the right decisions. Is there any action required on this? If so, what's the next action? Is there a project embedded in this you need to capture? And then being able to then populate your list of projects and next actions by going through and emptying out your in basket. That takes a couple of days to do. So it doesn't take actually very long, and you get a lot of stuff done just in that process. This is not some offline, theoretical, technical thing to go do that doesn't have anything to do with your life. This is your life. Those are the decisions you need to be making. But most people have really got quite a bit of backlog.
Who's up next?
Me. Hi, this is Nakia DeVita, fastresultsformula.com. I'm so geeked out by everything that you're saying. As a project manager myself, I pretty much systemize my life top to bottom, start to finish. Anything that I consider that I'm going to do more than once, I systemize it, document it, so that I can then delegate it. And my question for you is, in working with so many different people and high-level people, I'm wondering, have you noticed a difference in the systems that men versus women need to implement to be more successful?
No.
I didn't. Okay. I was just curious. Thank you.
I haven't found any gender bias, any cultural bias, anything. It really has to do with the complexity of their life as they're managing it. I know a lot of people who are people often say, are there disorganized people? I say, at what level? You might have a big, messy desk, but have a very clear vision about where you're going. So at the horizon of vision, you're highly organized. Some people with a clean desk are out of control in terms of where they're going in their life. They're using organization as a way to avoid it. So it depends, so different personalities will be more or less organized at those different horizons. But everybody still probably has an improvement opportunity about getting stuff off their mind and being a whole lot more efficient and effective about it. I haven't seen any bias, personalities, traits, any of that. Anybody who has to keep track of more than one thing, you know, they can't finish when they think of it, needs a systematic way to do that. And everybody's kind of in that boat.
So my question is kind of building on, I guess, what you just said, because there's been a ton of research done about different personalities, whether it's this system or the color code or whatever. And it seems as though just people have natural tendencies. Some are just spontaneous and creative. Some are more naturally organized and systemized. Some are just more interrelationship-based. Have you noticed any natural systems that tend to work better for certain personality types versus others?
No. For instance, frankly, the GTD system is the best for anybody. Mm-hmm. You know, that's a bias. There's my ta-da. How am I doing?
Very good.
GTD system is like absolutely, there is no way to beat that. All. You can't beat that one with a stick, because all it's really about is, it's not a system, it's a systematic approach. Okay. So the approach you would take, I've got all kinds of people in the, quote, creative professions out there that are big champions of my stuff. I don't know if any of you saw, any of you see me on The Office last week? My book had a little cameo.
Oh, I did.
There.
I was going to text you. I saw that.
Yeah. Well, the Simpson writers are all big GTD fans, and one of the Simpson writers went over to The Office. That's why he wanted to put the book into one of their issues. And they love it because, you know, for them, that's what they need is clear space. To write comedy, boy, you got to have a really clear head, like nothing else distracting you to be able to then focus on that. One of my biggest champions is Evan Taubenfeld, who was Avril Lavigne's guitarist. He's now got his own label he's doing his own stuff with Warner. And Evan is, you know, he as he said, before GTD, he started 100 songs. Afterwards, he finished 100 songs. Wow. So, you know, to bring stuff across a finish line, I don't care how creative you are, but a lot of the artists will tell you that is going to be their biggest job, is to actually have to hold that, you know, to keep doing that. And so the part of this that allows that to happen, so first of all, GTD helps them clear their head, because that's what they are after, is that creative space and that clear space. And it also gives them an execution capability so that all the nitsy stuff out there that you love to hate takes as little effort as possible. You can just get that handled. Now, the people who really are more sort of sequential and results-oriented, so they love it because, hey, this is now a sequential. That's why my stuff took off in the tech world, because they said, David, you just described all the subroutines of how you empty your head and your in basket. So it's very much like software works. Okay, here's the algorithm of what this works with. So again, back to that, I haven't seen a bias for either right brain, left brain, though that's a little simplistic to think about it that way. Kind of everybody out there, but they may do it for different reasons. Some people will do it because this gives them better relationships, better sense of creativity, more of a sense of fun and spontaneity in their life, and some people do it because they get more bang for the buck in terms of producing more results with less effort. The zen of it is it's both.
So this will probably be the last question, but here's the thing. David, how long are you going to be with us?
I'll stick around for lunch.
Okay, so David, Asa, Wendy. So I want to get to all of you guys, but just due to time. So David's going to be here during lunch. So you guys can go spend some time over lunch and ask him the question. So who is the next person?
I was next.
Harris, okay.
Well, first of all, I wanted to let you know that I've probably read hundreds of books in my life, and I could probably count on one hand, if you cut my thumb off, the four that had a profound effect on my life and my productivity, and yours would, of course, be one of them, so I wanted to thank you for that. Mm-hmm. Secondly, we haven't really talked too much about the restoring energy side. You did cover a bit of, like, biorhythm, and you gave me permission to nap, if I recall correctly, which I appreciate that, too.
Me, too. Love naps.
So thank you for that, too, but has there been any kind of new research that you've known of over the last 10 years? Kind of in the restoring energy side of the world, or what would you recommend to kind of dig down into that a bit more?
I just recommend reading Tony's stuff if you haven't read it. Tony Schwartz, he's been kind of on the front end out there in terms of researching that stuff about restoring energy and working on cycles, your cycles of energy. So he's been an accumulator. He was a journalist to begin with, so he started just doing a lot of research on it. So I think Tony's probably mashed up the best research on that stuff.
Is there a first book of his to template?
You know, I forget, they retitled it. It was The Way We're Working Isn't Working. That was the original title of it. Positive Engagement was before Tony's. He wrote that with Jim Lohr. But the one Tony wrote by himself was called The Way We're Working Isn't Working. And if you Google that, you'll find out whatever the new title of that was. But that has a lot of his sort of the four areas, you know, the emotional, mental, physical, spiritual side of your life, and how to build cycles into all of those. So I got from Tony taking naps, man. I mean, so a 25-minute nap in the afternoon about 2 o'clock is absolutely brilliant in terms of, you know, working with energy. So that's there. The other research I've seen, I mentioned already, is actually sleeping on stuff that they've discovered the unconscious actually can knit stuff together. As long as you have an intention, the unconscious actually won't pull stuff together out of a hat. You actually have to put an intentional affirmational process in. You need to want to have a solution for something. You need to want to make sure that the article is brilliant or great or creative, and then you sleep on that and then let the other parts of you work on it. But I think restoration and understanding cycles is great. A lot of, you know, Tony is a big champion of my stuff because the what can screw up your psychic energy on an ongoing basis is all this stuff that people have on their heads. And GTD, as I say, and this is one of my issues, I've talked to some of the marketing folks in here in terms of, we've got the biggest issue about positioning GTD. I solve a problem most people don't realize they have. What GTD solves is that, any of you ever in a room that had a buzz, but you didn't know the buzz was there until it stopped? That's what this is. Most of you, the reason you still have stuff in your head is that you're so used to that buzz, you don't know what it's like to not have that go on. So just being able to get to clear space really has a huge effect on your energy. Right. Huge.
True.
You know, it's kind of like, you know, when you get your car washed, it drives better.
Right.
Doesn't it? Sure. Oh, it does. Yeah, it does. It drives better.
And you're happier.
Oh, yeah. Well, and if nothing else, you know, enjoy the game. But it's so much nicer to have your brain freed up to just do whatever it wants to do as opposed to have, I need cat food, oh, I need cat food, oh, I need cat food. Shut the monkey up. But you don't shut it up by drinking or meditating. You leave it with one and you numb it with the other, but it's still going to go on until you do this, until you capture that and appropriately engage with your commitment about your cat. If you want to wait till the cat jumps on your face, that's fine. But, you know, you probably should handle it as soon as it pops into your head Once you do that, you'll find you'll find that you won't need as much restorative energy. You'll walk around much more restored. It's an ongoing event. You should just be in your zone most of the time, as opposed to having that exceptional.
Thank you. Yeah. All right, so great question, by the way. All right, so a tradition at Saying, we have a pretty influential community from marketers, social media experts, brand builders, organizational experts, whatever you might need. How can the community support you?
Well, we're going globally. The folks, David Covey and Stefan Mardix, who were the COOs of Franklin Covey, are now franchising us around the world. So that's launching in December, trying to figure out how to position GTD as opposed to just getting organized or being productive, which is not very sexy. So how do we get 10 million people into the top of our funnel instead of a million right now? And how do we open this to the world? The next book is going to be a book for parents and caring adults about how to use daily teaching moments to teach this thought process to your kids before they splat themselves into the world. So how do we let the world know that this is not a nice to have, this is really a must have in the kind of world that we're going forward? And so how do we position this globally? You know, is this a get freedom, get clear, have a relationship stuff, or is this produce more results with less effort? How do we get past the sort of unsexy, be productive, work harder, be organized, you know, image? So figuring out how to position the brand like that, that'd be fabulous if we could get that story right.
So is there anyone in the room who could just maybe just stand up just so David could see who you are in case you can have some any advice or feedback or counsel or resources? Just stand up for a second.
I talked to Howard already. He gave me some great stuff.
So Mari Smith in the corner's got probably about a reach of 600,000 people on social media. Just look around the room. Nate over there is one of the top LinkedIn experts in the world. Wendy Keller's a big book agent. I just can't see out there. Howard Lim's a big branding expert. But anyway, cool. Jill Lubin, big PR expert. So cool. Go see them over lunch and get to know. So two things. Just before I release David, so he is going to be here for lunch. I would just ask, hold off all coming over just for a second because I just want to make a couple quick announcements before I send you guys to lunch. Is it okay? All right. So, first of all, thank you so very much.
Yeah.
I appreciate you.
My pleasure.
And we'll look forward to having a great lunch with you, too.
Sure.
Ladies and gentlemen, let's give it up for Mr. David Allen.